Claiborne Farm, the home of Nasrula, the king among thoroughbred stallions. Nasrula was succeeded by his most famous son, Bold Ruler, who produced 82 stakes winners. And his most famous son, Secretariat, breezed through the Triple Crown, first to do so in 25 years. Retired after his three-year-old campaign, he too was to stand at Claiborne. A much less heralded champion, South America's Horse of the Year, Forley, was also brought to Claiborne. In the spring of 1969, Forley was bred to Lady Golconda, a minor stakes-winning mare purchased by the Lazy F Ranch. On April 30th, 1970, Lady Golconda dropped a large, gangly bay colt. Little did they realize that in several years, most experts would rank him with the best handicap horses of all generations. From the beginning, Forgo was marked to be a good one. While greatness cannot be forecast for any unraced youngster, he was one to watch. A rich, dark bay with few markings, he was so big at 2 and 3, some considered him unattractive. But he had a beautiful stride. Just as important, he was competitive. John Ward Jr. comments.
Well, during his early training as a yearling, and more so the early part of his two-year-old season, the fitter he got, the harder he got to work with. He became pretty rank and became very hard upon himself as a horse. It was felt by the people at that time that the gelding would help him to be a better horse and to be a better racing tool.
Cheryl Ward, his trainer, raced him for the first time on January 17, 1973 at Hialeah, and he was fourth. 1973 was to be Secretariat's year. Forgo finished fourth in the Kentucky Derby, and on June 9th, the day Secretariat demolished his field by 31 lengths in the Belmont Stakes, Forgo, half an hour earlier, won this allowance race so brilliantly that many remarked he had been in the wrong race. He was a comer. This race was the turning point in his career. Forgo had been ridden for the first time by Heliodoro Gustinus, and the huge gelding was maturing, his body filling out to complement his handsome and intelligent head. Cheryl Ward and his good friend Eddie Hayward, who took over when the trainer was ill, were caring for Forgo's ever-present ankle infirmity with skill and patience. They guided Forgo to 9 wins in 18 starts, ending the season with stakes victories in the Romer and Discovery handicaps. With Cheryl Ward recovered from open-heart surgery, it was back to Florida for the 74 season. Forgo started his four-year-old campaign with back-to-back victories in the Don and Gulfstream Park handicaps over the fine older horse, True Knight. Track handicappers were fully aware of Forgo's ability. And in this, the Widener handicap, highlight of the Florida season, the two rivals were to meet for the third time, with Forgo giving True Knight 5 pounds.
Racing down the backstretch, play the field on the inside, strictly business. Right there, these two noses and strides apart on the lead. 3.5 lengths, further back, that Santorine racing third. 4 horsepower, fourth. There goes Forgo up on the outside, beginning to move to the leaders. As they near the far turn, it's play the field in front by a neck. Strictly business racing second. And here comes Forgo with jockey Heliodoro Gustinus driving to the leaders on the outside. Santorine right there between horses. More horsepower along the rail. A gap of 4 lengths. Golden Dawn and True Knight last and beginning to accelerate along the inside. With less than a quarter to go, it's Forgo up to take the lead on the outside by 1 length. Opening up by 1.5 lengths at the top of the stretch. Here comes Play the Field, battling back gamely on the inside. And True Knight coming into contention, trying to slip through in close quarters on the rail and in trouble. With less than an eighth to go, it's Forgo in front by 1 length, now by 1.5 lengths. That's True Knight coming on once again with a belated bid. Here comes the finish, the victory to Forgo, going across the line by 1 length. In second position, that was Rory Dan Farms, True Knight.
Forgo came north with a perfect Florida record and warmed up by starting in the 7-furlong Carter, the East's leading spring handicap for sprinters. He was last early, then moved with his characteristic spurt, striding out around the field and won easily. Established as a star of all distances, he would now learn the duties of a heavyweight champion. In the Brooklyn Handicap at 1 3/16, Forgo would give up to 18 pounds to his six rivals. The day was hot and sultry. Forgo, who always preferred cool weather, was not one to let that stop him.
Arby's Boy in fourth position. Forgo on the outside, free hand and far back. Sip, sip, sip. They're on the far turn now, and Dancers Verde holds on to the lead by three lengths. Stoop dropping back as Billy Come Lately moves up, and there goes Forgo in the middle of the track with a rush. Arby's Boy also closing strongly with free hand. At the head of the stretch, there's a quarter of a mile to the finish. Billy Come Lately has the lead by a head. Dancers Verde on the inside. Forgo now third on the outside. Middle of the racetrack, it's Arby's Boy. And down the stretch they come. Billy Come Lately on the inside. And Forgo on the outside challenging and getting to the front by a head. Forgo on the outside takes the lead. Billy Come Lately second and Arby's Boy. And as they come under the finish line, it's Forgo.
He won Brooklyn at 1 3/16. And in September, he won the first of his four Woodwards, a great come-from-behind effort at 1.5 miles. His major fall goal was the 2-mile Jockey Club Gold Cup, but it was 6 weeks away, and Cheryl Ward preferred to keep him sharp. Thus, Forgo engaged in the most remarkable 2 months of his racing career. Between the 12-furlong Woodward and the 16-furlong Gold Cup, he would run in the 7-furlong Vosburgh, and under 131 pounds.
And they're off. On the outside, Mo Bay going for the lead with the Infuriator between horses now getting to the front. Lone Tree is next on the inside, Camback. Far outside, Mo Bay is now fourth, followed by Forage on the inside, fifth. Champagne Charlie is sixth by one. Prince Dan Tan is seventh. Forgo between horses, followed by American Kingdom on the outside, then Stop the Music, Arby's Boy, and Swamp Victory. Down the back stretch. That's Infuriator on the front end by two lengths. Camback is second by one. Lone Tree is third by two. Forage on the outside is next, followed by Prince Dan Tan. Around the five turn they go. Infuriator in front by three parts of a length. And Camback charging up on the outside to challenge. Lone Tree a closer third. Forage is fourth by a head. Prince Dan Tan is fifth. Champagne Charlie Forgo along the rail. Stop the Music and Bo Bay as they turn for home. Camback takes the lead. Lone Tree on the outside is second. Along the inside, Infuriated drops back, and between races, here comes Forgo with a rush. As they move into the final furlong, Camback on the rail. Forgo charging up on the outside, getting the lead. It's Forgo in front. Backing top lead to 131 pounds. The Adora Vecinas guides Forgo under the wire to win about four lengths.
After the Vosburgh, trainer Ward said, the easiest horse in the world to run long or short. And now he would run in long, the longest of his career, in the Jockey Club Gold Cup.
Through on the outside, third by six lengths, and now Forgo has moved into fourth position. Arby's Boy is fifth, and there goes Cop moving up on the outside. Mongo Go is next, and Freehand. Down the back stretch. Group Plan holds on to the lead by a length and a half. Stonewalk is second by a head. John Drew third. On the outside now, Forgo is fourth by half a length. Along the rail, it's Arby's Boy Cup. Then Mungo Go and Freehand is eighth. Around the far turn, the final time. And Group Plan has the lead by a length and a half. There goes Forgo rushing into second position and moving to the leader. It's Forgo on the outside up to take the lead. Group Plan battles back. Cop moves into the third spot. Stonewalk drops back fourth. John Drew is fifth. Arby's Boy, they're in the stretch. And now on the outside, Forgo takes the lead by a length. Group Plan is second. Cop is now third and Stonewalk fourth. An eighth of a mile to the finish end. Forgo has the lead by 2.5 lengths. Group Plan second on the rail and Cop third. 70 yards to the finish. It's Forgo in front. And Forgo with the Eleodora Vecinas takes the Jockey Club Gold Cup by 2.5 lengths.
These three outstanding victories at such varied distances concluded Forgo's four-year-old season. He won 8 of 13 starts and lost only to horses carrying many pounds less. Without question, he was Horse of the Year. And he was also voted Handicap Champion, plus Champion Sprinter. At the Eclipse Awards dinner in San Francisco in January 1975, Martha Gary accepted 3 Eclipse Awards. In 1975, Forgo won another widener, the Carter, and narrowly missed in the Metropolitan under 136 pounds. Next was the Suburban, and he would carry 134 pounds at a mile and a half. In modern racing, only one other thoroughbred, Exterminator, had done that and won.
Regaining the lead by a head, Loud second by two. Group Plan is third by a length. Forgo inching up now. On the outside, it's Arby's Boy. On the inside, American Kingdom gains ground. Golden Dawn is seventh past the half-mile pole. And it's Monetary Principle showing the way by a head as Loud moves to challenge now. Arby's Boy with a rush into third position on the extreme outside. Group Plan is fourth. Forgo is fifth at this point. American Kingdom sixth as the field moves to the top of the stretch. Loud on the outside. Along the rail, it's Monetary Principle. Arby's Boy is third. Those three across the track as they turn for home. Loud gets to the front by a head again. On the outside, Arby's Boy challenges. Forgo is third at this point in the middle of the track and moving to the leaders. They come to the eighth pole. Loud on the rail. Here comes Forgo on the outside. Arby's Boy between them, three of them across the track. Forgo on the outside getting the lead. Arby's Boy second and Loud back to third. It's Forgo and Arby's Boy. Forgo wins it by a head. Eleodoro Vecina is in the irons.
After a short midsummer rest, Forgo is back for the fall campaign. In the Governor, he finished fourth to Wajima, the handsome colt who was to be voted three-year-old champion. 2 weeks later, in the Marlboro Cup, Forgo, unable to get outside where he usually made his stretch run, lost by a head to Wajima again. Was the younger generation taking over? The mile and a half Woodward against Wajima would give Forgo another opportunity to show who was king. Cheryl Ward said, "We have a score to settle."
Past the 5/8 pole. Wajima gets the lead by a head. On the inside, Avatar. On the outside, Forgo. The half mile in 49 3, and 3/4 of a mile, 113 2. To the half mile pole, three of them battling for the lead. It's Avatar on the inside, Wajima between horses, and Forgo on the outside. Those three across the track. Now Wajima gets the lead by a head. Forgo up on the outside to challenge. 3/8 of a mile to the finish, and Forgo takes the lead by a head. Wajima is second. Avatar drops back to third on the inside. Okavango is fourth. Group Plan and Freehand as they turn for home. It's Forgo on the outside in front by a head. Wajima is second by a length and a half, and Avatar is racing third. And down the stretch they come. On the outside, Forgo. On the inside, Wajima. Forgo on the outside, Wajima toward the rail. Forgo has it by 3/8 of a length. Wajima is second past the 16th pole, and Forgo pulls away in front. Eleodoro Vecina is aboard. Forgo under the wire. The winner by 2 lengths. Wajima was second.
After his brilliant Woodward, Forgo again was voted Horse of the Year and Handicap Champion. Two more Eclipse Awards. But he had run his last race for Cheryl Ward. The quiet trainer, a horseman all his life, was retiring because of poor health. He had developed through patience, skill, and understanding one of the great horses of all time. As a six-year-old, Forgo was turned over to Frank Whiteley Jr., another horseman's horseman. The big horse carried on. Coming back in May, his objective again, New York's Handicap Triple, beginning with the Metropolitan Mile, a race which had twice eluded him.
Nora! On the inside, Valid Appeal quickly takes the early lead. Lord Rabot on the outside to challenge. Master Derby is racing third, Northerly is fourth. Then Nelly's Rialto fifth, and Forgo is sixth down the backstretch. Valid Appeal has the lead by a length and a quarter. Lord Rabot is second by the same margin, with Master Derby third by a head. Northerly on the outside, right there, fourth. Forgo is now fifth by half a length. Nelly's Rialto is sixth on the outside as they move down the backstretch. Valid Appeal leading by 3/8 of a length. Lord Rabot second. Master Derby between horses third. Northerly on the outside is fourth. A gap of 3 lengths. Forgo is racing fifth. With Nelly's Rialto sixth, they move past the half-mile pole that way. It's Valid Appeal in front by half a length. That's Lord Rabot between horses second and Master Derby on the outside third. Northerly dropping back fourth as Forgo moves up on the outside past the 3/8 pole. It's Valid Appeal on the rail holding on to the lead by half a length.
Lord Rabot on the outside, right there, second, and Master Derby joins the leaders. Four goes fourth as they turn for home, a quarter of a mile to the finish. Bennett Appeal on the inside, Lord Rabot between horses. Master Derby on the outside, those three across the track, with one length farther back, Four Go closing in on the leaders. A furlong to the finish, Master Derby gets the lead. Four Go on the outside, now second, with Lord Rabot third. It's Four Go on the outside, coming on to take the lead. Four Go and Master Derby. Here's the finish.
Stamina, consistency, and class were Forgo's trademarks. He captured his third Brooklyn under 134 pounds, with Heliodoro Gustinas riding him for the final time. Other stable commitments by Gustinas necessitated a change in riders, and Bill Shoemaker got the call. He won another Woodward, also his third. He carried 135 pounds, and the shoe aboard for the first time was impressed. Next came the Marlboro Cup, which twice had escaped Forgo. He would be asked to tote 137 pounds, an awesome burden carried successfully at more than a mile by only four major winners in modern American racing. When it rained and rained and the track came up sloppy, it was the impossible challenge, and maybe Forgo's greatest of so many great races.
Forgo is now eighth on the outside. Has the lead by a length and three quarters, and that's Dance Spell second by a half. Father Hogan on the inside, third by one. Life's Hope is fourth. Romeo fifth. Now Four goes sixth on the outside, and Right Mind is seventh. It's Honest Pleasure maintaining the lead by two lengths. Dance Spell is second by a head. On the inside, Father Hogan. Life's Hope is next, and on the far outside, Four Go into the stretch. Honest Pleasure has the lead by a length and a half. It's Dance Spell second. Father Hogan on the inside third. Four Go gains ground on the far outside. A furlong to the finish. Honest Pleasure has the lead. On the outside, here comes Four Go. Father Hogan toward the rail. It's Honest Pleasure. Four Go on the outside. Four Go on the outside. And Honest Pleasure. Here's the finish. Too tight to call. Four Go on the outside.
Most exciting race I think I've ever seen, because we really didn't think he was going to make it and weren't quite sure that he had, because he was carrying top weight and more weight than anyone's ever carried in the Marlboro. He was out in the middle of the track, and our box is beyond the finish line, so we really couldn't tell whether he'd won it or not. It's the most gratifying thing in the world.
Following the Marlboro, Bill Shoemaker called Forgo the best horse he's ridden, the ultimate compliment. He was again named Horse of the Year for the third time. Forgo was getting old, but he did open the 77 season with three straight wins, including the Metropolitan. 10 lengths out of it on the turn, Martha Gary said to herself, not today. But suddenly he began to move, caught his field, and won by 2 lengths. Forgo's popularity became such that on Monday, June 13th, with the strike closing all mutual windows, almost 8,000 fans still came out to Belmont to see him win the Nassau Handicap. In his next two races, both second place finishes, he was giving away 24 and 25 pounds to his conquerors. Quiet little table and great contractor. Next was the Whitney at Saratoga. The track was heavy and not to his liking, and he finished last in a field of 7. The Woodward at Belmont was his next start, a race he had won 3 other times. It rained through the night and morning, and the track was sloppy. The decision to run was not made until 45 minutes before post. Trainer Whiteley turned to Martha Gary and said, "If you're game, I am." She was game, and so was Forgo.
It's J.O. Tobin taking the lead by 1 length, moving alongside is Centillo in second. Then it's 2 lengths back to Affiliate and Silver Series, followed by Capital Idea, then Co-Host, another 3 lengths, and Wise Phillip, Forgo along the inside, then it's Great Contractor, and finally Proud Birdie. Moving down the back stretch, on the inside, Centillo is up to take the lead and now has it by 1. J.O. Tobin is second on the outside, 2.5, and Silver Series third by 1. Affiliate is fourth, Co-Host in fifth, and on the outside, Capital Idea. Those three are together. Then it's a gap of 3 lengths to Forgo. On the outside, Wise Phillip, then Great Contractor along the rail, and finally Proud Birdie.
They're on the turn. They went a half mile in a quick 45 and three-fifths. The leader is Centillo, leading by a half. J. O. Tobin is second by three-quarters. Silver Series into third on the outside, and here's Forgo. He's going to run today, folks. He's moved into fourth. They're coming for the head of the stretch. Along the inside, it's Centillo, then J. O. Tobin, Silver Series, and Forgo on the outside. Great Contractor is making up ground, and he's down along the rail. They're in the stretch, and it's still Centillo holding on. Silver Series is here to challenge, but Forgo is on the outside, and he's moving very fast. Coming for the wire, that's Forgo on the outside. He's got the lead as they come for the wire. Here's Forgo taking over by one. Silver Series holds second.
1978 was an abbreviated season. An allowance win in June and a fifth-place finish in the Suburban. Chronic infirmities had again caught up with him. The Garys and Frank Whiteley agreed he would race no more. With 34 wins in 57 starts and earnings of nearly $2 million, he was going home to Kentucky and a life of leisure. He made his final New York appearance when he led the post parade for the Marlboro Cup. Despite the presence of Seattle Slough and Affirmed, two Triple Crown champions in the field, Forgo received the largest ovation from his faithful and loyal followers. And so, Forgo went home. Home to Kentucky and John Ward's farm. Where just a few short years ago, he was an unruly and undisciplined yearling. Now free to romp and graze in his three-acre paddock, just a furlong from the Keeneland backstretch, Forgo receives visitors like young Track Firestone, who stops by daily after school. Each spring and fall, when they're off and running at Keeneland, the roar of the crowd may make Forgo look up and wonder why he's not there. Racing followers and Forgo had a long-lasting love affair. Perhaps this poem, written by a Forgo fan, expresses it best. I wait, wait till this long winter ends, tired of snow and waiting for Forgo. I'm longing to see those soft eyes again, the proud, strong bearing of our friend. He's above all the clamor and noise as he gazes at us with his noble poise. Be there, Forgo, for all your friends to see among Belmont's spring scenery. I don't care if you ever run. Who could disprove what you've already won? You've won the hearts of young and old. Your legend will be forever told. Why don't they show you each day of the meet, since your contribution to racing is already complete? Racing will never be the same, except for the mere mention of your name. Forgo.
Naira Rewards is
a rich, dark bay with few markings. He was so big at 2 and 3, some considered him unattractive. But he had a beautiful stride. Just as important, he was competitive. John Ward Jr. comments.
Well, during his early training as a yearling, and more so the early part of his two-year-old season, the fitter he got, the harder he got to work with. He became pretty rank and became very hard upon himself as a horse. It was felt by the people at that time that the gilding would help him to be...
Claiborne Farm, the home of Nasrula, the king among thoroughbred stallions. Nasrula was succeeded by his most famous son, Bold Ruler, who produced 82 stakes winners. And his most famous son, Secretariat, breezed through the Triple Crown, first to do so in 25 years. Retired after his three-year-old campaign, he too was to stand at Claiborne. A much less heralded champion, South America's Horse of the Year, Forley, was also brought to Claiborne. In the spring of 1969, Forley was beaten for the first time by Heliodoro Gustinus, and the huge gelding was maturing, his body filling out to complement his handsome and intelligent head. Cheryl Ward and his good friend Eddie Hayward, who took over when the trainer was ill, were caring for Forgo's ever-present ankle infirmity with skill and patience. They guided Forgo to 9 wins in 18 starts, ending the season with stakes victories in the Roamer and Discovery handicaps. With Cheryl Ward recovered from open-heart surgery, it was back to Florida for the 74 season. Forgo started his four-year-old bred to Lady Golconda, a minor stakes-winning mare purchased by the Lazy F Ranch. On April 30th, 1970, Lady Golconda dropped a large, gangly bay colt. Little did they realize that in several years, most experts would rank him with the best handicap horses of all generations. From the beginning, Forgo was marked to be a good one. While greatness cannot be forecast for any unraced youngster, he was one to watch.
Better horse and to be a better racing tool.
Cheryl Ward, his trainer, raced him for the first time on January 17, 1973 at Hialeah, and he was fourth. 1973 was to be Secretariat's year. Forgo finished fourth in the Kentucky Derby, and on June 9th, the day Secretariat demolished his field by 31 lengths in the Belmont Stakes, Forgo, half an hour earlier, won this allowance race so brilliantly that many remarked he had been in the wrong race. He was a comer. This race was the turning point in his career. Forgo had been ridden.